Welcome back to Let's Play Torment, Tides of Numenera. I'm the RPG chick. We are approaching the end. Just made our way through the broken fathom. His daughter was in the stasis chamber, the changing gods' daughter. And now entering the deepest fathom. Just say before all that, we are fully healed. Have all our stats. She was able to heal us. I guess she might be able to do it again, but I don't know if we can come back from the deepest fathom. What's interesting is this is episode 136, Planescape Torment.
All right.
Made it 139 episodes, so interesting to see how many episodes. Very, very similar.
Making a note.
Quest updated. The right to exist. I found the door to the resonance. The specter isn't here, but the door is inaccessible. There are two other doors I can access. Maybe I can use them to get into the resonance before the specter knows I'm here. Still wondering where the hell Allegern and Rin were. Or are. Oh, I remember this. This is from the Dark Fathom, the very beginning. So this is where we can't get in. This massive door leads to the resonance, but it is barred by a sturdy brass cage. We return to the beginning. That goes to an illuminated door, and that goes to a marred door. Hope? And, I don't know. More like light, right? And then dark? Good and evil. Not necessarily. So it's called the dark... Oh, it's back to the dark fathom. It's a deepest fathom when we went in here. So yeah, it's like the... I believe it's my first episode ever. It's called, you know, part one. It's called Dark Fathom. Because that's where we begin. Of course, there's more over this way with the pool of light and all that stuff. Let's try the illuminated chamber.
Ready.
These are alternate things I might explore the other chamber, if you can only get to one. We'll see. Countless scratches and wounds mar the surface of this door. Someone made a great effort to get inside, but to no avail. As you approach, however, the bars of the door shudder and bend. It wants to let you in. What does this one say? Dude, what's mine say?
Now.
Sweet! What's mine say? Dude. The light around the door's frame dims and flares like a roaring fire in a high wind. As you approach, the bars of the door shudder and bend. It wants to let you in. I do want to go through the light one, though. I feel like...
Let's go.
Light is a little more hopeful. I just wanted to see what it would say. Place your hand on the surface and will it to open. The door doesn't open at your touch. Instead, you are drawn into the door itself. Alright, whatever works. Oh, cool. That's like a mirror. You're in a glass dome several kilometers above the ground. Blue sky fills your vision. Beneath you is a floor of golden metal. A deafening klaxon blares in warning against something. Yeah, I remember this. It wasn't in a mirror like this, but it was like through just text. Well, but without this image. From the beginning, the Dark Fathom. A familiar-looking stasis chamber lies in the center of the dome. A chest fashioned from synth and cold iron sits to one side. Behind the pod, a diamond hovers in the air, scattering prismatic light. A pedestal glows near your hand, a deep azure blue. There is nothing that seems to warrant the blaring klaxons, yet you know the alarm sounds for a reason. Look at the chamber. It's the ghostly woman's stasis chamber, the real one from which the labyrinth constructions were made. The changing god's daughter lies inside. Her skin is pale, and there are dark circles around her eyes. Her chest rises and falls as though she were sleeping soundly. This laboratory, this body, must belong to the changing god. It's a stasis chamber. Inside lies the real version of the changing god's daughter. Her chest rises and falls in a soft, peaceful rhythm. Investigate the hovering diamond. As soon as you approach the diamond, the top of it blooms open. An illusory globe appears within. Words and image speed across its surface. A woman's voice speaks directly into your mind. Welcome back. Please state your query. A wave of familiarity slams into you. The changing god used this as an archival device. He kept records of his thoughts and experiments. Specific records can be retrieved by speaking a search term. Alarm. The illusory globe becomes blank. The voice speaks into your mind. There are no matching entries. Please restate your query. Escape. Previews of several entries flit through your mind. There are scores of results, and you can't figure out how they're organized, nor how to quickly ascertain whether an entry will be useful to you or not. It takes some time to sift through them for something useful. You'll have to be careful what you spend time researching. I will. Finally, you find one that you're looking for. A male voice, the voice of the body you are wearing, speaks in your mind. Is this a hint? I'll have to be careful. Your voice says, I won't take any risks with this new body. I've initiated a fail-safe procedure to transport me away should something happen to me or the laboratory. If any unforeseen danger presents itself, I should be able to escape to a backup location. The tides. Your voice says, the tides have proven to be an extremely fruitful path of exploration. The Tabat don't realize what they have unearthed. They saw these trinkets as just more Numenera, but these forces may even have the power to turn back death itself. I certainly hope so for her sake. So he uses the tides to... Right. Yeah, we know that, actually. He uses the tides to keep himself alive. He uses the tides to force himself in and out of people's minds. Oh. There's a thunderous boom. The floor shakes and sways beneath you, causing you to lose your balance. Outside the dome, the horizon tilts back and forth, giving you a sense of vertigo. Suddenly, a man appears in front of you. He's not all there. You can see the clouds and vista on the other side of him. He wears a look of human terror on his face. It's broken into the tower. The tower, it's only a matter of time before it reaches us here. We have to do something fast. His mannerisms remind you of the specter from the labyrinth, though his face, clothing, and voice are not the same. I really want to hear about the daughter, though. What's here? Why are the alarms going off? His face darkens. The sorrow is here. It found us somehow, and that's trying to break into the lab. We need to get you out of here. The sorrow. It's making scraps of our defenses. It's just a matter of time before it gets here. The floor of the dome shudders frighteningly, as if to emphasize his point. I just want to see what happens if we delay. What are you? He gives you an odd look. Now's really not the time to get into this again. I'm an intelligence put in charge of this laboratory, and either created from or overlaid with your knowledge and personality. As your advisor, I refuse to argue about the nature of my existence until we're safely out of this mess. Can you make the alarm stop? Sure, just don't forget that the reason for the alarms is still in its way. The blaring alarms cease immediately, replaced with a low rumbling and an occasional crash of metal. I'm your advisor, he says patronizingly, and as such I advise you to let the nature of what I am go for the moment in light of more pressing matters. Why is the sorrow here? What does it want? I couldn't tell you what it wants. Maybe there's something in your archives. You told me we woke it up somehow, then we did that first consciousness transfer. The first consciousness transfer, huh? Yeah, into the first cast-off. Tell me about the girl in the chamber. You mean Mika? Oh, Mika. That's her name. Finally, we know her name. He looks at the chamber. It's difficult to read his expression, but he seems sad. She's no better than she was before. Worse, actually. I hate to say this, but I don't think we can save her. Tell me about the storage locker. What about it? Last I remember, you moved a bunch of new stuff in there while I was deactivated. I don't know anything about what you've put in there. He crosses his arms. Really, I don't see how I could advise you at all when you keep things from me. Tell me about the diamond. Your archives? The archival interface doesn't work with mine directly. I only know what you upload to my database, which you haven't done in years, by the way. Until then, those are just notes to yourself. He reaches out a hand suddenly. If you're thinking of going through those looking for a solution, be careful. We don't have a lot of time, and you've made a lot of notes. How close is the sorrow? It's nearly broken through the electrostatic barrier. We don't have much time. Open the synth chest. The chest is locked with a keypad bearing 17 strange symbols. You're about to lose hope when you realize you know which symbols to press to unlock the chest. You can enter the correct code before the memory can slip away, or you do enter it. The chest opens with a soft click. The only items of note inside are a wooden shaft with a multicolored crystal tied to one end and a large hemisphere made of azure steel. Examine the rod with the crystal on the end. There is nothing mystical about the wooden haft, but the crystal on the end is definitely from a prior world. You think it might be a domination rod. The crystal saps the will of any creature it touches. The rod has a good heft and balance, like a well-made spear. It may or may not help you, but it will do more good in your hand than in a box. Examine the azure steel dome. It's heavy. Too heavy to lift by yourself. Your best guess is that it's a wall projector of some kind, probably brought up here as a defensive measure for the laboratory. Unfortunately, you can't see any indication of what kind of barrier it would create, nor any way to activate it. But we can't take it? Archival diamond. Daughter. There are no matching entries. Please restate your query. Domination rod. Nope. Wall projector. A picture of the azure steel dome from the chest appears on the globe inside the diamond. Your voice says, "The panel was not easy to find. There are no visible seams anywhere, but it's easy to open once you know it's there. As soon as I found it, I had the transdimensional wall projector moved to the new laboratory. I don't know what, exactly, destroyed the old location, but I know it was transdimensional in nature. The projector should create a barrier large enough to surround the entire dome in case whatever it was comes hunting again." So we should activate the rod. Suddenly there is a tremendous popping sound. The air sizzles, causing every hair to stand on end and your entire body to tingle dangerously. The spectral man appears in front of you again. It puts its hands on your shoulders, though you feel nothing. It shattered the electrostatic shield. If it breaks through the plasma window, we're done for. I love all this stuff. Plasma window, electrostatic shield. It looks at the hatch of the in the ground as though it could see through it. What's your plan? You've got a plan, right? Activate the wall projector. You find the panel mentioned in the archives. Once you know where it is, it slides open easily. You place your hand on the black glass inside. It grows warm at your touch, and there is the smell of a light rain. A low hum murmurs at the edge of your hearing, and the air outside the dome begins to shimmer. The shield appears spherical. You can only hope it will buy you some time against what's coming. Consciousness transfer. Your voice says, "The consciousness transfer was a success. I transferred Mika to a new body first, a clone of her original. There appeared to be no ill side effects after several days, so I performed the procedure on myself. I'll be watching both of us carefully over the next few weeks, but thus far I am very hopeful. I'm sure there will be unforeseeable long-term effects, but for the moment it seems I have found a way to stave off death itself. I cannot imagine any long-term effects that could outweigh that benefit." So that's interesting. He tried to save his daughter first, and he was like, well, I can do this for myself, too, because I'm not going to live forever. The Tabat. Hoping we have more time now with this thing we did, the projector. Your voice says, "The Tabat were fools, but they were skilled scavengers, gifted with the luck of having discovered the Underspine. I still don't know what the Underspine is, but I'm convinced it came from the Talad, the same people from which I gleaned the powers of the tides and figured out the key to consciousness transfer. It's the best explanation for the Tabat's success. Without the Underspine, they are little more than abhumans of above-average intelligence." The Changing God. The Sorrow. The voice says, "I don't know what the Sorrow is exactly, just that it's old, really old, and it doesn't pay much attention to established laws of space-time. I wonder just how established those laws really are. Anyway, I first came across mention of it in my research of the tides. It appears to have been some kind of guardian against tidal abuse. Evidence suggests it may have been solely responsible for the destruction of one of the prior worlds." Oh, really? So we're in the ninth world, so one of those eight other worlds was probably destroyed by the Sorrow. Interesting. My experiments with consciousness transfer appear to have woken it. I don't believe it's after me specifically, but I've come to believe it was responsible for the destruction of my previous laboratory. So it all just listening again. Mika? Your voice says, "Mika's condition has not improved after the consciousness transfer. If anything, it has worsened. I've traced the cause to the weapon I retrieved from the Tabat after their failed siege of Sega's Cliffs, but damned if I know how to undo its effects." There's an agonized pause. "I don't understand. I should be able to figure this out. I will figure it out. I just need more data. I've discovered a theoretic process to merge my consciousness with hers, but I just need more data. With luck, I can run experiments in the next few days." Oh, boy. Yeah, too late. There's a hiss and a screech beneath the floor. Suddenly, the metal hatch flies off its hinges, cracking the strong glass ceiling, then smashing the glowing pedestal. The spectral man's image appears. A foul black cloud rises from the hatch, and the air is filled with an unearthly wail and a stench of rotting flesh. Tendrils lash out, slicing metal and synth wherever they touch it. A terrible face emerges from the cloud. It examines you, then it turns its attention to the chamber. Use a domination rod against the Sorrow. With a shout, you shove the crystal deep within the Sorrow's form. Nothing happens. Huh. The Sorrow turns its horrible attention to you. One of its tendrils darts toward you, slicing through both the strong glass wall and steel floor. It reaches your face and you feel nothing. The tendril goes right through your body. You realize that the dome is fading away. No, your body is fading away as some device tugs it safely away to another location. Sorry, guys. Hope no one got blasted out with wearing headphones. The Sorrow's unearthly wail becomes a shriek. No kidding. Though the spectral advisor is gone, you hear his voice in your head. "Thank goodness the failsafe kicked in. You'll be safe, though the girl and I are doomed. I'll be easy to recover, but she... I'm sure you'll..." He's cut off as the Sorrow's tendrils flay the laboratory all around it in a blind fury. The chest and diamond are cut to ribbons. The chamber disintegrates in a ball of purple flame, and the last thing you see as your mind fades from this body is the face of the young girl, melting and boiling into ash. That's horrible. But that's what actually happened, right?
"I'm ready to learn something new."
I'm sure you are. The ghostly woman appears next to you. Actually, no, she's not next to us. She's over here. She stares at the door you just emerged from, her eyes round as the moon. "I remember now. All of it. I remember how it started. I told you I was aware of everything while I was in that chamber. I remember my father abandoning me. I remember, too, how you risked your life for me. After the Sorrow destroyed the stasis chamber, I woke up here, in the labyrinth. I wasn't aware, though. Not for a long time. Not until you came and started changing things. What do you mean I started changing things? She looks at you. Her eyes are brighter now, full of confidence. You are the last cast-off, the one my father created to witness this place, to command it. You have been changing the labyrinth since you were first born. You are the one who will decide our fate. Really? Those changes have finally helped me remember who I am. So you're not just a memory? No, she says, firm and certain. I am not a memory, nor a reflection, nor a lacuna. I am Mika, the full consciousness of the changing god's daughter. Just as you are the full consciousness of yourself, I am the full consciousness of the changing god's daughter. But I couldn't save you. You tried, which is more than I can say for my father. You risked your own life. Besides, if you had died in there, you and every cast-off would never have existed. Maybe there are some realities you can't change. I understand all that I need to. So what do we do now? She points to the door on the opposite side of the fathom. There is one more mirror. Open it. Or enter it. Open the I feel like I've been reading too much, guys. I'm trying to get to the end. Enter it. Open the resonance and end this for all of us. Go. There was not much time. But we're all like... I got resonance power. Resonance power. Plus 20% movement speed. Plus 5 initiative. Plus 15% evasion. And willpower. And on all tasks. Okay, so... Now, I can level me up. Let's increase might. You know, I don't know what we're gonna need. Might to 14. Who knows, I might need everything for what's to come. Not much time. All right.
I'm ready.
Go into this one. The light around this door dims and flares like a fire. The bars shudder and bend as you draw near. It is prepared to let you in. You are drawn into the door itself, just like the other one. A world revolves far below you, a sunset in scarlet flaring on the horizon. To the east, deep indigo shadows fall, painting the planet with darkness. The faintest shimmer of a forest screen distorts your vision, and the exhalation of the station pushes warm, moist air across your skin. Oh, I've seen this, but it had color. I've seen this as part of the artwork, the promotional material for the game. You hold an intricately filigreed metal staff, its carvings slither under your fingers as if it were alive. Is the same staff we used? You are in a great hall that is more like an organic space than a constructed room. Machinery literally sprouts from the floors and walls, with no sign of where the synthetic metal gives way to the substrata from which it has grown. Though human, the hall feels clean and fresh, healthy and vibrant, full of promise. A holographic map of the moon hovers at the back wall, near a small glowing pod. A voice speaks, as if from the air itself. Are you certain this procedure will give you final control over the cast-offs? If you're mistaken, the chamber may fail, or worse, detonate with you inside. The voice is familiar, but you can't quite put your finger on its identity. Where are you? By your side as usual. Watching. Monitoring. The resonance chamber is ready in Sagus. We just need to make sure that this body will work as a catalyst. If something happens down there, I'll signal you to move to the next vessel. And if you don't get out in time, well, you've got me. Let's hear it for redundancy. For now, just settle into the pod, and we'll make sure this body will work for us. You've pinpointed the source of the voice. It's coming from the staff in your hands. You peer at it more closely. and you see a glowing, ghostly image. The holographic advisor from the other mirror. No. This advisor looks different, augmented. It has the ghostly, blue-limbed, smoky appearance of the Spectre. It is the Spectre. I know you. I would hope so, considering that you duplicated me from your own mind less than a week ago. Now let's get you into the chamber and... Are you feeling alright? You're a duplicate of my mind? Yes. A note of concern enters a spectral voice. Hold one moment, please. A slight buzzing radiates from the staff. It permeates your being and encompasses your mind. Oh, I see. You're a new mind in this body. How did you get here? Wait. You're a cast-off. That means that this body is the catalyst. We'll be able to activate the resonance chamber. I need you to listen very closely to me. Your body is the key to stopping the sorrow. We just need to get you into the chamber and our struggles will be at an end. Clearly, we didn't make it to the resonance chamber in your timeline. If you change history here, you run the risk of destroying yourself. So, what happens? I'm not entirely sure. I woke up in an escaped cocoon. Then disaster strikes here, and that sounds like the sorrow is coming. We need to get you off this moon, and quickly. If the sorrow destroys this place, all is lost unless you can escape. This is a repository for all our wisdom, all our knowledge, and its loss will be a disaster. But if we can't stop the sorrow, we can at least save your life. And mine. Get into the pod. Remind me how the process works. I've already said that we know your body is prepared to use the resonance chamber, but I want to be sure that all of the parameters are within tolerance. I don't know if your tides have shifted out of variance. If they have, we can try to massage them back within the guidelines your creator and I established. Just step into the pod and we'll start that evaluation. I'll run the evaluation just after you step into the pod here. It'll bathe you in some tidal energies and we'll assess our next steps. Try to remember how the staff works. You study the staff and it feels like coming home. It is a familiar friend, a comforting ally. It is the cornerstone to this moon, a key to every lock. You know that it copies your mind weakly, serving as a failsafe and a familiar, a consciousness that is your natural ally. So it's your backup. It's like a computer-assisted backup. When it speaks with the Spectre's voice, and when it must manifest, it can create a ghostly image of the Changing God's original body. Holding it, you feel safe, in control. What if I do this? I don't want any part of this. I've been trying to stop this from happening. Oh, for goodness! An invisible force suddenly whisks you into the pod against your will. Boy, don't have a choice about that. The staff in your hand vibrates slightly, and you feel yourself bathed in energies. Remain calm. This is all well within normal parameters. The minor explosion that follows, however, surely is not. Sudden klaxons blare. Another alarm. The nearby platelets vibrate furiously, and the deactivated construct's arm begins to spark and flare. Get out! The sorrow is going to destroy you. Your nemesis manifests in the Great Hall. Its form is tenuous, wispy, as it congeals. It gains solidity in fits and starts. The moon's internal defenses are slowing it, but they will not be enough to keep it out. As you watch, the sorrow shrugs itself past another line of defenses, jerking itself toward a more terrible reality. Its focus snaps toward you. It coils and writhes, desperate to wipe you from existence. Get to another body. We can always make a new catalyst. Go. Do we have anything that can stop the sorrow? The Spectre's laugh is half a sob. Stop? No. Slow? Maybe. Look around. I'll try to keep it occupied through the station's defenses as best I can. Study the map to find the way to the escape pods. 100%. It's a multi-level projection. Its orientation and layout is prepared in a way that is naturally pleasing to your eye, and you trace the route to a nearby escape cocoon without difficulty. You'll have to remember the layout of the halls, but the map is clear enough that you think you can remember the route. Do I have time to examine the construct? I want to get away, guys. Don't believe me, but I'm trying to absorb as much lore and story as I can. I don't know why we would try to do that. Smashing? The construct itself is beyond repair, but a quick study reveals that each of the construct's limbs were designed for independent power. So even though most of the construct is quiescent, its spike-powered hand is not. Working quickly, you detach it from the construct's frame. It will be a suitable gauntlet. The powers that course through it might serve to delay the sorrow's advance. Okay, should we try this too then? Quick fingers and natural lore. Try to pull off one of the vibrating platelets. You take hold of one of the discs. Your fingers sink into its spongy material, and with a slight twist of your wrist, you detach it from the column of energy that holds it. It hums and cycles in a pitch that makes your eyes shudder. With each cycle, the disc shifts your vision, changing the colors you perceive. The tides churn within you as you hold it. It may have some effect on the sorrow. You feel the moon shudder. Then you feel it tear. The alarms in the great hall have begun to strobe. The lights flicker. The moon's moist air suddenly shrieks past you. The sorrow has breached its walls. The hallway branches, with countless offshoots piercing the winding passages of the moon. You know that your escape lies down one of these routes. Your study of the map puts you in good stead here. You count down the passages, and every landmark that you expect arrives when you expect it. As you race down the halls, you see a small slot in the wall. It holds a firm green gel that you know contains some kind of memory. I have to figure it out. I can't just pass that by. Try to figure out how the green memory gel works. You press your forehead to the gel. It soaks into your skin, leaving behind a dry viridian paste. You are constructing the staff you hold. The specter speaks over your shoulder. This is strange, isn't it? Knowing that I'm watching you make my home, that I'm going to be updated in a week with your experiences, that my consciousness will fill this moon, and thus so will you, in an unbroken, indefinite chain. You say, I don't hold any illusions about the sanctity of consciousness, but then you know that already. He laughs aloud. This conversation is turning us into a solipsist. You smile. We've been called worse. The memory fades. Keep running. Get to the escape pods. You pound into the bay, the door shutting behind you. Your breath comes hot in your chest. You double over to catch your breath. Several cocoons are arrayed along the outer wall. You'll need to activate one, and it will spin its webbing around you. The smart membrane is tough, heat resistant, and it will transfer the entirety of the kinetic force away from you at the moment of impact. You see an injection of some sort, but it's across the bay. You might not have time to reach it. Injection? Cocoons, activate one. The sorrow tears apart the wall in a fury of light and tidal energy. The flickering energies inside its hood betray no emotion except hunger. It is inexorable. The most you can do is hope to slow it. Use the gauntlet that you took from the construct. You slip the gauntlet over your head and hold it out in a warding gesture. The energy that blasts from it tears the sorrow apart, decohering it utterly, stripping your foe to its component fragments. I honestly didn't think that would work, mutters the specter. Silence reigns in the bay for a moment, and then the sorrow manifests again, threads of acid smoke weaving themselves together. Guess not. You only have one defense left. You hardly trust it will be enough to get you to the cocoons and off this doomed moon. Better to run straight for the only hope of escape. Okay, so I'm guessing... Yeah. It's telling me to get to the escape pod, basically. So I'm gonna get in there. I don't know what the injection is. I kinda wanna know, but... You slip into the cocoon, activate the ejection sequence, and trigger it. The membrane embraces you, forcing you to drop the staff, and begins to slide free of the killing ground of the moon. And then your tattoo blazes, as if it's tearing open, an onslaught of the tides, all in blue and silver, a stream of information too fast and too large to process. A mighty blast buffets the cocoon, and you feel one of the sorrow's inky tendrils caress your cheek and burn into your mind, searing away knowledge and memory, even as you tumble toward the earth. Amidst unspeakable pain, you feel something new forming within you, but you lose consciousness before you can identify what it is. I wonder what it was. Huh. We're back. The door opens. Oh. Who are these? I'd hoped you would open that for me, and here we are, the Spectre says, and his voice is not tied to his body. It pours from the walls around you, from the shifting floor beneath your feet. It's time for some hard truths, child.